state. So we'll talk about that as we get into this. Just a touch of review. We're going to flip through these very quickly. We talked about the message that Jesus preached. Remember the message that Jesus preached. It was not necessarily the gospel of grace that we know it of today. Jesus Christ and John the Baptist both preached, repent for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Okay? That's what these verses say. Repent for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. The gospel of the kingdom is talked about there among Jesus Christ. Why? Because John the Baptist is speaking to the Jewish people. Jesus Christ says, I came not but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Okay, so he's preaching this message to the nation of Israel, and he's trying to get the Jews to repent so that he can usher in his kingdom. That's what John the Baptist was there for, and that's the gospel that Jesus Christ preached. The Jews wanted the kingdom so bad, remember this, that they wanted to take Jesus Christ by force and make him their king. So in the Jews' mind, this was all about the Messiah coming and setting up the kingdom. They did not see a rapture. They did not see a church age, by the way. Okay? All they saw was what you and I would know as the millennial kingdom. We talk about what is the Old Testament. We know that the Old Testament runs right on through the death of Jesus Christ. Because Hebrews tells us that you can't have a testament until you have the death of the testator. Okay? So when Jesus Christ died, then all of a sudden we have the beginning of a New Testament. The church age then is ushered in at that point. This is all review, so you can go back and get the archives of this if you want the full teaching. But the beginning of the church age, I told you that it was somewhere essentially between Matthew chapter 16 and Acts chapter 2. What is the most significant event that took place between those two events, places in time? I believe is the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Even the Apostle Paul says, if it were not for the resurrection, you and I would yet be in our sins. I believe at the resurrection of Jesus Christ, that is the beginning of the church age, okay? Now, you could argue with me about that. We could still have coffee, and you can buy me a steak dinner if you want. But that's okay. I'm just saying, between Matthew chapter 16, clearly the church had not begun yet, and Acts chapter 2, the church had begun because he was adding to the church. Somewhere in between there is the start of the church age, and I just happen to pick the resurrection of Jesus Christ because that is the most significant event. You look at the current position of the church age. The Lord addresses seven churches in the book of Revelation. They represent seven segments within the church age. It's very interesting. If you look at these periods of time on a map, essentially you see over there on the left-hand side, AD 30 to 100, and 100 to 313, 313 to 600. You see these ages, these periods in time, they line up almost exactly the description that's given of each church age in the book of Revelation. So you see this whole church age thing winding out. It's a very interesting study. If you look at the church of Ephesus and Smyrna and Pergamum and Thyatira and Sardis and Philadelphia and Laodicea. I mean, we looked at Laodicea just as an example last week, and the Bible says you are rich and increased with goods, right? You're lukewarm. And you believe that you have need of nothing. Doesn't that describe the church age that we live in today? We're lukewarm, we're apathetic, we're all rich, we have need of nothing. You say, well, I'm not rich. Well, according to the rest of the world, you're rich. I'll tell you that right now. America has raised the standard of living for the entire world. There is no other church in church history that has as much material possessions as most churches around the country or around the globe. And the church age of today fits the description of Laodicea. And Jesus Christ chastens that church. And he says, but you don't know that you're poor, blind, miserable, and naked. Okay? You don't know that you're spiritually bankrupt because of this apathy. He gives instructions on how to fix all of that. So we look at the church age and we walk through Revelation chapters 1 through 3. And it's interesting to look at that because we saw the end of the church age, which if you go to Revelation chapter 4 with me, Revelation chapter 4, please take your Bibles and turn there. It's interesting to see this, okay? So you have church, 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 church mentioned from chapters 1 through 3. Over and over and over, the church is talked about, the church this, the church that, the church here, the church there, okay? Then you have Revelation chapter 4 in verse number 1. After the last church is exhorted, the church of Laodicea, and he says, after this I looked up, and behold, a door was opened in heaven, and the first voice which I heard was, as it were, of a trumpet talking with me, which said, come up hither, and I will show event that ended the church age. Of course, it was the rapture of the church when Jesus Christ comes to take the church away. Amen? We talked about that, and that is a very significant event. So the end of the church age is the rapture of the church, and it essentially happens, scripturally speaking, Revelation chapter 4 and verse number 1, come up hither, the trump is sounded, the voice of God happens, and the church is gone, just as described in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, by the way, where it says, comfort one another with these words. So we see the rapture of the church. We have a couple pictures here that depict the rapture of the church. Okay, the truth about the rapture is simply Jesus testified of it. Paul wrote about it. Misunderstandings about the rapture, we talked about this. I'm just trying to get some of us up to speed here. Matthew chapter 24 is not a prophecy of events that happened before the rapture. Please understand that. Many Christians get that confused. And they read the events in Matthew chapter 24 and they say, well, this is the precursor. These are signs before the rapture. Nothing has to happen before the rapture but the voice of the archangel, the trump of God. That's it, okay? That's it. That's all that has to happen for us to be out of here. So all of the events that are laid out in Matthew chapter 24 are the events of the tribulation period, okay? If you're seeing those things take place as described in Matthew 24, then let me tell you something. You're in trouble because you're in the tribulation period. Now, we see the precursor to a lot of those things happening. Okay? We see the foreshadowing to a lot of this stuff taking place. But certainly the events that are described in Matthew 24 are not directly fulfilled at this point because that's the tribulation period. Now, the closer we get to the rapture, the more we'll see the pieces of the puzzle start fitting together. But they'll really come together after the church is gone. It says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse number 13, to meet the Lord in the air, that is different. The rapture of the church is different than the second coming. I hope that you understand that. A lot of Christians get confused. That's why I keep talking about this over and over. The second coming is not the rapture. The second coming, or the second advent, is when Jesus Christ comes back after the millennial kingdom, at the end of the tribulation to set up his millennial kingdom. That is the second advent of Jesus Christ. The facts of the tribulation are mistaken for the signs of the tribulation period. Matthew chapter 24, verse number 3, even the disciples said, what is the sign of thy coming and the end of the world? They did not say, what is the sign of the rapture? They did not say, what is the sign of the taking of the church? Because they didn't know about the church and they didn't know about a rapture. So often we read a Jewish book through Gentile eyes, and that's not a good idea. You have to understand that Jesus Christ was speaking to his disciples, who are a bunch of Jews. And they're not worried about the church. They know nothing about the church. They're not worried about the rapture of the church because they know nothing about the rapture of the church. They asked Jesus Christ, what is the sign of thy coming and the end of the world? And he goes on to describe these events. And the tribulation is what takes place before he comes. Okay? So he's very accurately telling what's going to happen. Three signs, as we mentioned already. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse number 16. The Lord's shout, the archangel's voice, and the trump of God. Those are only three things that need to happen before the rapture of the church. And those can happen at any time. So we better be ready to go. Amen? Okay? Those are the only things that need to happen before the rapture of the church, and they can happen at any moment. We talked about a brief prediction about how God uses sevens, and we talked about seven and 7,000 and the age of the earth, and basically we're not talking about knowing the day or the hour, but the Bible says we can know the seasons, okay? And if you look at the rules of seven in the Bible, we certainly see that even that tells us we are extremely close to the coming of the Lord. If you missed this talk, you can go back to the archives and you can get that where we explain that in great detail. The judgment seat of Christ is where I want to pick up here tonight and move into this because a lot of people are confused about the judgment seat of Christ. I even have people telling me, well, Pastor Brandon, don't you know that the judgment seat of Christ doesn't exist? And I wonder where people got this from, this whole idea that the judgment seat of Christ...